walking wounded were all herded together in three small rooms, about 200 of them, and they were all bayoneted a few at a time.
When our fellow bombed and there was a great rush to get back on the train, he got trampled under and sort of died in that.
It was thick with oil, you could cover it up with oil, you're dark with oil, all these tankers were burning around us.
The Australian stood out on his own. That is why most of us come back, because we all help one another.
Many of their comrades didn't fall in battle, but succumbed to disease, malnutrition, and brutality. Building a railway. In 1942, the Japanese High Command regarded it as imperative to link the existing railway networks around Bangkok in Thailand and Rangoon in Burma with an additional 240 kilometers of narrow gauge track. They completed the project in an amazing 15 months at the horrific cost of over 116,000 lives. In December 1941, almost simultaneously with their attack on the American Pacific Fleet at Pearl Harbor, the Japanese armed forces launched a multi-pronged attack, landing at Singora and Patani in southern Thailand and Kota Baru in Malaya, making the long-anticipated threat to Singapore a reality. Defenders, a mixed empire force of British, Indians, and Australians, were ill-equipped and questionably deployed. They failed to halt the rapid advance. With formidable air support from bases in Thailand, the Japanese army pushed relentlessly down the Malay Peninsula to the island fortress. Increasingly disorganized and demoralized, the defenders retreated into Singapore itself, as the Japanese reached the Straits of Johor. A quick victory was vital to the Japanese. Their supply lines were dangerously extended and unreliable. The soldiers were tired from incessant fighting. Using a combination of aerial bombardment, naval and artillery shelling, and pure bluff, the commander, General Yamashita, convinced the beleaguered island of the hopelessness of its defense. On February 15th, 1942, the British Commander-in-Chief, General Percival, unconditionally surrendered his garrison to the numerically inferior Japanese force. What Winston Churchill later described as the worst disaster in the history of British arms since the loss of the American colonies had happened. Singapore had fallen. For the Commonwealth and Dominion soldiers, to the indignity of defeat was added the humiliation of having to parade respectfully in front of their conquerors. Early 1942 was the peak of Japanese conquest. They had gained all the objectives they had set themselves, with the possible exception of the total elimination of American Pacific Sea Power. They controlled the sources of oil, rubber, and minerals in Southeast Asia and the Dutch East Indies. In Burma, their armies threatened British India. In the south, Australia and New Zealand lay virtually defenseless. Everywhere, their forces were supreme. The Japanese were embarrassed by the staggering amount of prisoners they had taken. To them, surrender was the ultimate shame and humiliation, and the prisoners were treated accordingly. For many, long years of captivity began here.
To a point, it was something akin to living in a barracks establishment of pre-war style. However, it was so overloaded because of the number of people. It wasn't quite like the old standards, but it was something like it. And in that first month or so in Changi, it was a reasonable life, even though, of course, we were incarcerated and there's no joy in that anyway.
Initially, the prisoners' greatest problem was boredom, and they devised ingenious ways to overcome it.
We'd been captured about 6-8 weeks when our commander, Brigadier Galligan, decided that we would be there for some time. I think that was fairly obvious, and he thought that, not only thought, but was insistent that we have entertainment. And so he sent round a message to all of the units to find out who had been professionals, semi-professionals in civil life. And the engineers built a theatre, so the concert party was formed. One of the things is, of course, Captain Takahashi, who went to Brigadier Galligan and said, "It appears your boys like these shows." He said, "Yes, they do." Next day, he ordered us to pull the theatre down.
They had won their empire. Now they had to defend it. They had to exploit the newly acquired territories without delay or lose the war. Already, the Allies were recovering and attacking the sea approaches to Rangoon, making the supply of the Japanese forces in Burma increasingly difficult. To avoid the long and hazardous route through the Straits of Malacca, it was decided to build an overland supply route from Bangkok to Rangoon, a narrow-gauge railway linking Ban Pong with Thanbyuzayat, a railway through one of the most impenetrable, disease-infested jungles in the world. The labor force for such a massive project existed in the prisoner of war camps and amongst the local populations of the occupied countries. Heedless of the seemingly insurmountable engineering problems they faced, the line was commenced.
For me, the trip to Ban Pong on the Singapore to Bangkok railway started off with being herded into Singapore railway station in the dark hours.
And we'd been locked in steel trucks, or more or less clamped in steel trucks, on a metre gauge, 32 to a truck for 5 days and five nights.
And this didn't really allow for all people to be properly seated on the floor of the van. There always seemed to be somebody still standing up and no spare space around anyway. And as far as laying down was concerned, well, that was only done with people laying half on top of each other and this sort of thing.
Well, to be quite frank, the stories the Japanese had told us when Air Force was being sent away to reinforce the earlier groups that had gone into Lower Thailand and into Burma to work from opposite ends of the railway, that the food was getting short in Singapore, which was true, and they wanted to ship a lot of men away to relieve the food shortage situation, and they more or less gave us the impression that we were going to a land of milk and honey. Well, when we first arrived at Ban Pong, that's exactly what we thought we were in, because we hadn't seen fresh vegetables and fresh meat in the quantities that we received. And, you know, we were having stews with just full of vegetables. And
in our first arrival place, Ban Pong, when we got off the train, and the camp was established, well, God, suffering cats, we'd never seen so many eggs in all our life. We had an egg stew.
But all this was to rapidly change as the prisoners were moved out to their future work camps.
And, you know, we were saying, where are the trucks that are going to take us to our camp? And then we sort of found out in no uncertain fashion that there were no trucks and we were going to walk. And he gave us the understanding then that we'd be walking for well over 100 miles. Nobody believed him at that time, but that wasn't too long before we found out that he'd been telling the truth. So we followed the course of two different rivers in Thailand, and we walked along as close as possible to the banks of the river, but I suppose to get away from Allied air observation, we used to march of a night time, and we'd march about 16 miles a night, then we'd rest the next day, march the next night, then rest the next day and the next night. Now, this went on until we'd covered the distance that our particular group, I think it was about 180 miles we walked from Ban Pong right up to a place called Con Coita. You can imagine walking 16 mile a night with the clothing and everything else that you had to carry, and towards the end of the night, the column was straggled out quite a long way, and the Japanese didn't have any sympathy for anybody that fell behind, so it was basically doing your best to help your mates sort of keep up. And you might find two people carrying their mate or half carrying him and sharing his pack to get him into camp, because there were a number of cases where people that fell behind and just couldn't get up were, you know, shot or bayoneted.
Finally, arriving at their destinations, they were often put to work before their own camp huts had been completed.
We left there with Otty and we went up to a place called Brincassi. And we started to build bridges.
Building the bridge, of course, consisted of cutting down the great logs out of the jungle and then carrying them back by hand, floating them out into the river and then standing them up where they had a barge with a trestle on it and a pile driver. And the pile driver was man-powered. You'd have anything up to 20 or 30 men on ropes that would be just dragging on the pile driver, and this would go on for 8, 10, 12 hours a day.
This Japanese propaganda film of the time portrays an altogether different lifestyle to that which really existed. One gets the impression the actors weren't altogether serious about their performances.
Commodities are supplied to us. Not plentiful, but rationed enough to keep everybody going on a normal scale. Nevertheless, the boys need the extras, such as a cigarette lighter, a pack of cards, or a bottle of beer. Small and simple things, but mightily welcome. So payday, as in ordinary life, plays an enormous part in the welfare of the boys in camp. Part of the pay is saved for their families back home, and the rest goes in for the necessary odds and ends desired. So here you see them, as they naturally are, after payday. The canteen being the most popular spot.
You tried to preserve your clothes, whatever you had left, and you worked in what used to call a G-string. And this is what the Japanese used to wear. It was like a loincloth. You just tied a cord around your waist with a piece of cloth about, 18 inches long and about 9 inches wide, and you just brought it up between your legs and looped it over the cord.
Well, I hope things are as peaceful as this.
Yes. Our sincere hope is to maintain the freedom, independence, and prosperity of Australia.
Frank Rich was an unwilling participant in such a propaganda film.
Invited down there one day, hurled into a truck. And we were taken to the Singapore Swimming Club, which was the big thing in peacetime over there. That was the ultra in society to be a member of the Singapore Swimming Club. Beautiful place. And trunks were provided, and we were all swimming around thinking this is beautiful. And then in come the cameras. And they're taking photos of us, which I believe was shown later, of look at how the Japanese treat their prisoners of war. But for lunch, we still had 3 or 4 ounces of rice. They didn't carry it too far in the place. We didn't get any extra.
Where there's smoke, there's fire. And this indicates that long before the first rooster crows and the rest of the camp awakes, the kitchen hands are on the job. This well-equipped, efficient kitchen frees the boys from kitchen drudgery and gives them more time for other interests. Daily menus are accurately timed, and loose instructions are given to ensure well-balanced meals, which will put anyone into a party mood.
All you used to get was a Dixie half full of rice in the morning with a fairly watery sort of a stew made up of, you know, some sort of cabbage leaves. And you'd have rice carried out to the working party, which you'd eat cold. And when you'd come back at night, it'd be more of the same.
Rice, rice and rice. One bloke found a fig tree. We wished to God he'd cut his throat. We had figs for about 3 weeks straight off. Breakfast, dinner and tea. If anyone offered me a fig, boy, I'll cut their bloody throat from now on. I'll tell you what, if you eat figs for day or night for 3 weeks, it's bloody awful.
Probably the poorest rations that I ever received was up in the region of Temonta on the Burma Siam Railway, where we were issued with a teacup full of rice gruel twice a day. And that wasn't nice boiled rice in grains. It was just simply a pappy, porridgey gruel. Yes, a few onions apparently were thrown in at the kitchen, and if you were one of the lucky fellows, you did find a small piece of onion in your cup of rice gruel. But we existed on this for some 7 or 8 days, and I can tell you it's below subsistence level.
One gets the picture of Australians right from the time we were in camp before we went away, that the Australian is really is happiest in adversity. It seems a strange thing, but when we were at Pakapanya, we were getting the best of food and the best of everything was coming in, but everyone was grizzling, saying, yeah, bloody food there. Now, when we were captured and our same cooks were cooking rice and they hadn't cooked it before, it was terrible, first off, naturally. And one limed rice that they sent, it was dreadful. But if you did complain about the cook under those circumstances, he's doing his bloody best, and here it was bad, and yet they were happy about it, you know?
You were on pain of death if you had any conversational exchange with Thais or that you had any contact with them. And similarly, of course, the Thai people would be killed for any exchanges with us. But there was quite a magnificent organization. It was a slender one which carried supplies and helped right up the Kwanoi River during the railway construction period and later. The money really came from the civilian internees camp, but the agents that actually carried the money upriver and contacted us and really did some magnificent work were Thais.
They really sympathized with the war prisoners and they tried to give them food. They tried to send them the eatable things, see? And but it was caught by the Germans. The Germans tortured them.
The Japanese infantryman himself, when the campaign in Burma was going against them and they were being marched up into the fighting, we saw lots of sort of mateship amongst them with the heavy machine guns and that they had to carry and being chased and hounded along by their officers. There were a couple of Japanese officers who were fairly civilized in terms of their treatment of the prisoners of war, but it was very, very rare on the railway line.
On one occasion, this was really quite extraordinary, in which an ordinary sort of one-star private, the lowest sort of grade in the army, stood between me and an enraged sergeant with a bayonet who was out on bayonet fighting practice when I fell into some sort of controversy with him as to what he was doing with my sick. And he was so maddened by what I had to say that he just charged me to bayonet me, and this one-star private defended me, you see, because I belonged to his group and this other fellow was another group, and I just don't understand how he got away with that, but he got me off that parade ground in one piece.
Although discouraged in many of the camps, religion persisted, a comfort to many in their adversity.
There used to be church parades being held in right in the middle of the jungle. I can remember attending communion services in the middle of the jungle and assisting in the service on a number of occasions.
There certainly was a tendency for people to perhaps have a greater appreciation of their maker. And in fact, there was no way that we could rely on our own resources or those of any other man anyway to get us through the situation we were in. It was something, as I think, anyway, for God, and I'm sure that the good Lord looked after me. No doubts about that.
Actually, I'm not a religious man, but I've seen all these tough fellas and blokes who have a go and everything, and they laugh at it. I've prayed, and there's very few that haven't. When the going's down, the chips are hard, and everything's going bad, they all pray. And that little bit of help that gives you a bit of confidence to carry on.
We'd built an embankment about 3 or 4 feet high, and we'd been out to the going back and coming back to camp, working, coming back. And this particular day, in one of the excavations made for the embankment, there was an elephant and their family and daughters and so on. And daughters, mind you, we hadn't seen a woman for 6 months or so, and we're coming back, and this woman, and to us those days, to see a girl with nothing on up top. There's a fella in front, he's ahead of me, he's about 20 feet ahead, and there's culverts and two decent bearers across waiting for the sleepers to go. And anyway, he's ahead, and suddenly he sees the girl, and he goes like this, and the next minute he walks straight down the hole.
In May 1943, at the beginning of the monsoon season, commenced the worst period of the railway construction. Callously pressuring for a rapid completion, the Japanese threw in another 10,000 prisoners of war. 50% of these perished in 6 months. This was the Speedo period.
Speedo was the only thing the Japs knew in English that meant hurry up, and, you know, Speedo, Speedo, Speedo. And there was a great deal of pressure brought on the engineering, Japanese engineers, to get this line completed.
In that time, we lost around about 600 men in 14 days.
Before daylight and after dark, people were working, and the Asians were sort of literally worked to death.
These people, they were, worse off than we were. The Japanese were just as evil to them as they were to the prisoners of war, and they died like flies. I think their mortality rate would have been far in excess of that of the prisoners. Gosh, that was bad enough, as everyone knows.
But the Asians, I believe there was somewhere between 200 and 250,000 of these. These would be Chinese, Tamils, Malays, Indians that had been swept up from Singapore and Malaya and bundled up into the railway. And, you know, as soon as they died, they were just cast aside. There was nobody to look after them. There wasn't the same sort of mateship amongst them. It was a, you know, dog-eat-dog life. And there was a lot of that went in within our own ranks, I must admit, but with them, it was far worse.
It was tough. It was hard. The railway was shocking because you had no primitive ideas of trying to build a railway.
Perhaps from Hintock Mountain Camp, be 4 rugged miles over the hills, going up a bamboo ladder up the cliff, and then out over these slithering sort of mountain tops to the river, and then 8 or 10 hours, you see, of work there, and this involved an embankment which was built by hand, a lengthy rock cutting, and then this bridge over the ravine, which was about 80 feet above the level of the stream. This sort of process of wear and tear inevitably killed about a third of the men in 12 months. So another third look as if they lived very long, and there's nobody re-looked at he was up to much, you see.
This is probably the worst period of the whole line. I mean, people's health was deteriorating more, you know, the food was getting scarce, and the weather conditions were atrocious, and, you know, it was just from daylight to dark.
As the deadline for completion approached, the Japanese and Korean guards were merciless in their attempts to force the prisoners to even greater efforts. Men unfit to work received no food.
I seen a few atrocities on the line, a fellow called Lexi. I won't mention his second name because I wouldn't like these people to know anything about it. He had a big stump to pull out one day in the middle of the railway line. It was impossible for one man to do it. I don't care who he was. He could have been Hercules. He was about 4 foot across each way. He had to dig the stump out and pull it out himself. He dug all around the roots and killed all the roots and broke them. But he couldn't shift it. This fella called the black cook got a big stick and into him and killed him.
And the officer that was felt we'd had enough, and he said to the Japanese, they've had enough, they're going to have a rest. And the Japanese said, no. He asked me no, which means no rest. And the officer said, yes, they are. So he told us to stop, and we stopped. And the Japanese said, you tell them to start work or I'll kill you. And the officer said, no, they've had enough, they're going to have a rest. So he dragged his gun out and stuck it in the officer's stomach, and they had an eyeball-to-eyeball confrontation for about a minute or so. Eventually, the Jap backed down, and he said, you're a very foolish man, I could have killed you. But he said, you know, you're also a brave man, so he let it go.
The reason that confrontation had to be was to maintain the morale of your force, that it had to be seen that those who were in command or responsible position, that they did fight for the rights and so forth.
And these prisoners were, of course, they were badly treated. If they couldn't go to the work, you see, they're kicked. Some fellow was seen falling on the ground and nobody took care of. And even his friend wanted to help him, you see. They're tortured by the Japanese, kicked by the Japanese, slapped by the Japanese. Some of the prisoners, you see, they're not probably dead, you see. Even if they were taken out and buried alive.
Escape really wasn't on in Thailand until the closing stages of the war, in which there was the possibility of getting to resistance groups and army units that were forming in the jungle. And a few fellows did manage to make an escape at that stage. But what happened in the earlier stages of the war was that they were inevitably captured. They were so easily identified in the particular countries we were in, whether it be Java, Thailand, Burma, you stood out as an entirely different sort of human, you see, and you were easily rounded up.
Probably the most highly organized and best attempted escape was a group of British, particularly British officers who had some experience in Burma, and they had a fair bit of money, and they had the backing of some of the local people, and I understand they had an elephant or two, I'm not sure. Now, they got a fair way before they were reported by some of the local population further up, and they were all captured. Because if you realise where the line was being built from there to the coast were several hundreds of miles through mostly impenetrable jungle, or if you travel down the rivers. But then if you were lucky enough to get there, you had to find a boat, and the closest point there was around about Trincomalee or something in Ceylon or India. And if you survived the jungle with malaria and not being able to light a fire to cook food, and you couldn't live off the jungle. But this particular group that I spoke of, after they were captured and sort of brought back and beaten up a few times, they were publicly executed in front of the people from the camp where they'd escaped.
When we got to Tavoy, there's eight of our fellas, there's four anti-tankers. They decided, unfortunately, they couldn't stand the situation. They were going to head off, and a few of us tried very hard to stop them. Unfortunately, they went. That was their idea, and they went. And 3 days later, they were all caught, and the next day it was a case of they had to dig their own graves, and two nips to each one lying low, and that was that, but no blindfolds.
It's good to be healthy, to enjoy games and sunshine, but some of the boys have been overcome by sickness. No pains are spared for their care and well-being. We have our own doctors who immediately report to the authorities whenever they find a man in need of medical attention. The best that science and kindness can give is always at our disposal.
The one thing, of course, you never got was all the things which you need to treat the sick. That you'd have to build your operating table, that you had no hospital or anything that looked like it. You just had to put people on bamboo. And there were no utensils or anything to treat the sick. There were no water bottles or bedpans, and all the paraphernalia, that all had to be made out of timber or bamboo. And if they needed a crutch, you had to make it, and so on, a crutch or a splint or An orthopedic bed was a thing made of bamboo with a sort of an ordinary nail driven through the bone to pull on, and so forth.
One camp, when we finished the railway line, or when it was almost finished, and we were transferred up into a place called Thanbyuzayat in Burma, which was a hospital camp for prisoners that had worked on from Air Force. And in a very short period of time, some month or two, they conducted 96 amputations in this camp. And these amputations were done with a wood saw that was used normally for cutting down trees for the campfires. And of course, when there was an operation on, this saw had to be boiled up in an army Dixie, a big Dixie. And then one or two scalpels and a half a dozen forceps, and these sort of legs and toes and so forth were being amputated. And the people were so debilitated at that stage that they couldn't survive the shock of the operation. I think out of 96 amputations, only four people lived. And people were dying in that particular camp at the rate of about 30 or 40 a day. And for weeks on end, the cremation priors never went out.
Cholera really is a scourge, and not just amongst the native people who have little idea of how to cope with it, but certainly even for us. And we had little in the way of treatment. The only treatment that I know of that was given was simply a saline drip. They would hook the leg up, one leg up in the air, open up the vein and drip a salt solution, saline solution, into the vein. And this way we certainly saved some of the people.
A tropical ulcer could be picked up from anywhere, a slight burn, a slight graze that would get infected. And particularly in the state of health that people were, and if they happened to catch malaria about the time when this ulcer was picked up, and these were usually in the lower limbs, like from the knees down, then it used to spread very rapidly, and it was quite virulent. It'd eat the flesh away. I remember one British soldier, this particular British chap wouldn't allow them to take his leg off. He was doing his best to save it himself. He wouldn't let anybody touch him, but he used to just bathe his leg practically all day. And at that time, I can remember quite vividly that the flesh had been eaten away from the calf of his leg, and all the sinews were exposed, and most of the flesh had gone. And the whole of his shin bone was exposed, and the bone, instead of being fairly white, was starting to yellow up. And it was even becoming sort of honeycomb, because the whatever there was in these ulcers was eating it through. And this was more or less the norm. And if they weren't treated, and the only other thing that the treatment, and the most drastic treatment, was to scrape them out.
The sore is, it's something like that. It became larger and larger, wider and wider, and until the patients died of the disease. Lots of people died of the disease. And it's strange that when the Japanese surrendered, or when the Japanese left, the disease gone too.
At times, in various jungle hospitals I commanded, with, say, a city of sickness of about 10,000 people, you'd have, say, 2,000, 2,500 men in the so-called hospital. And there you'd perhaps see 1,000 tropical ulcers and maybe 200 men with the bones poking out of their legs. This was the sort of instance of the condition there. It was a very serious problem.
At the end of 15 months, the line was completed. The irony was, it was never effectively used. It was being bombed faster than it could be repaired. Time was running out for the Japanese Empire.
There were one or two instances where Japanese engineers had made such a botch of building this line that the gradients were too steep, and prisoners were sort of forced to jump off and help push the train up over the rise, or the gradient was so sharp, or the bends were so sharp, rather, that the engines had jumped the line. But before they got much use out of it, the Allied bombers were taking over, and, you know, about 150 locomotives and hundreds of trucks of rolling stock were destroyed.
Those prisoners who were kept on to maintain the railway suffered bombings from their own aircraft. Others were put on board ships bound for forced labor in Japan. American submarines carried out devastating attacks on these convoys, unaware of the presence of the prisoners of war.
And we were torpedoed. We're in the water somewhere around about 5 days and five nights. There was no panic or anything like that in the boat, but we had no life jackets or anything like that on with us. We just carried packs, rubber packs that they loaded on, which was wholesale rubber. Well, the Japs, we seen them, they were taking the life jackets off the geisha girls, which they had on the boat.
We had one fellow, he was gone for all money. We had him sort of tied on our makeshift raft, and he kept pointing to this thing. and we wouldn't even bother to look. But anyway, we heard this sort of tick, tick, and next thing up she came. And he said, "There you are, I told you." But he just couldn't believe it. But, it's a miracle, really.
The survivors had often clung stubbornly to pieces of wreckage in shark-infested waters for days. They were blistered from the sun, covered with oil from sinking tankers, and starving. They had seen friends drown, or taken by sharks, or simply go mad from thirst and crazily gulp down seawater. Memories they weren't easily to forget.
The first thing we see to this submarine was like a big telegraph pole. You couldn't work out what it was in the water. And we didn't see a thing, and the next minute, this big sub comes up beside us. And these Americans came out of the submarine. And there's a big bloke there, he looked 6 foot odd. He was big beard, double barrel shotgun. He said, "Who the hell are you?" He said, "Australians." He said, "Well, turn your bloody hats up. You don't look it." As soon as they knew who we were, they dived over. I'll never forget it. The main thing sticks out. They put this beautiful white blanket around us and covered thick with oil and sunburn and everything like that. And what the Americans done to us was absolutely marvellous. They couldn't do enough for us. They were really good.
Unfortunately for many, rescue came too late.
There was 30-odd of us started off, and when we got picked up by the American sub, there was 8 there alive. 8 on there, 2 were dead, and 1 died on the submarine, out the lot that came out of it. When being interviewed, the American said, looked at me and he said, "How old are you, guy?" I said, 21. He said, 31. I said, "No, 21. He said, "God, you look nearer 41, you do 21. I was 7 stone 6 and I got picked up.
By mid-1945, the European war was over, and the Allies were now turning their full attention to the Pacific War. The Japanese rising sun was now sinking, and the end was inevitable.
It was important to maintain contact with the outside world, and this is one of the reasons why I had a wireless set through most of the period in prison camps. I eventually was arrested and had a tough time, and the last year I had other sources of information, didn't have the set working, but this sort of thing, of course, was important, that you could give fellow some fairly solid assurance of a victory ultimately, and hope.
The clandestine radio operators weren't to hear of the events on the Japanese mainland in mid-August until after the war. The cities of Hiroshima and Nagasaki were subjected to a new and frightening weapon, which convinced the Japanese leaders that further prosecution of the war was futile.
We sneaked up and had a look out of the top. We seen this plane coming. And their parachute come out, and one bloke said, the chap was with me, said, "I think he's dead now, he's Trevor," he said. "Well, I think they're gonna drop Pearl Lamp leaflets." We said, "Oh yeah, I suppose they are." Next thing was this hell of a bloody bang. A blinding flash, big smoke, and this big rush of wind. And I said, "Bloody hell, that was a big bloody pamphlet they dropped."
When the Union Jack was hauled above the Changi jail, there was the greatest cheer you ever heard in your life. But from then on, most people were sick, and there wasn't the jubilance that one would have expected, except everyone was happy in a quiet way, I think, that you were going home.
And the quicker you get there and things try to get back to normal, well, the better. And I think that's virtually how I viewed it. Bear in mind, I was young. I had my 21st birthday in Burma.
I recall old AIF Joe. Now, you remember old AIF Joe?
Yeah,
he was a reasonable sort of a Korean. And just after the war finished, he came up to us, and he'd been of a help. He used to come through and say, "Well, Sergio, the camp is going to be Sergio," and we appreciated it. Anyway, after the war was over, he came up to a friend of mine and he said, "What's going to happen to me?" And they said, "Oh, you're all right, Joe. We're going to shoot the others, but we'll hang you."
As the camps were liberated, the captors meekly became the captives.
We were even pretty good in the finish. We never missed out. I myself, I had sore hands for about a fortnight.
Over 116,000 native labourers and allied soldiers perished construct this fragile link between Bangkok and Rangoon. The The jungle has reclaimed most of the line. Some bridges and cuttings survive, but little else to indicate the starvation, torture, suffering, and death that took place.
Well, I suppose if you cut across all the brutality and the suffering and anguish that went on in there, the building of that line was quite an achievement. To build a railway line with absolute minimum equipment like axes and tools and hammers and dog spikes and logs, and some of those massive bridges they built were like, you know, made like matchsticks. And to do that over about 280 miles in something like 15 or 16 months was quite an engineering achievement.
I'll never forget. It would be a human impossibility. I've forgiven. As I see it, there's two generations passed since then. I've been back to Japan. The younger people are very friendly. The ones in our age group, the men especially, don't look at you too long in the eye. And it's very funny, but they seem to be as affluent, if more, not more, than we are.
They're on top of the world, we're on the bottom of the world. What was a bloody war for? To make them rich and us poor.
Well, I mean, even if I wanted a trip, I wouldn't take a trip to Japan. There's one place I don't want to see, and that I've no liking whatsoever for them.
I don't know. I'll put it this way, I don't own a Jap car.
And if there is such a thing as a God, why? Why this punishment? Why this starvation? Why this malnutrition, disease? No food, and then on top of that you get the beatings. Why? If there's such a God, why does he let this happen?
How will history judge the death railway? As a military necessity or a monument to brutality?
In the Australia of 1914, life for everyone was slower and simpler, and in most cases harder. Because of distances, the majority lived in smaller communities. They were isolated not only by the vast size of the continent, but by Australia being half a world away from Europe. 4 million Australians lived in a continent as big as the USA. Federation was only a decade back. In fact, most Australians thought of themselves as Victorians and Queenslanders first, rather than Australians. They were a tough, vigorous, and optimistic young nation, ready to respond to a challenge. April the 25th, 1915, Australians landed at Anzac Cove. Their war had begun.
We felt somehow we hadn't let Australia down.
We'd been tested and come through.
We reckoned we'd put Australia on the map. But the Anzac thing wasn't all about military heroism. I mean, the campaign was a failure in one sense. The reason we remembered it was to do with sticking together, looking after your mates.
We left a good many of them there.
I think that the only Gallipoli man we ever put a statue up for, Simpson, proves that point. Simpson, a rough and tough bloke, never even fired a shot. Just took wounded men down day after day under fire until at last they got him.
After Gallipoli, there followed 3 long years on the Western Front in France. Years of ordeal for the Australian soldier, during which he suffered the highest casualty rate of any Allied army. Despite this, the AIF emerged as the best small army in France and decisively affected the outcome of the war. The Great War, as it was called, was a heavy burden for a young country to bear. Those who fell on the battlefield and those who were maimed were a significant proportion of the young men of Australia, men who would be sorely missed in the years to come. There was one contemporary witness to the casualty rate who said, "How can a young country stand such losses?" An enduring quality these men brought with them from the Australian pioneering traditions was a sense of mateship, the caring for one's fellows, and being looked after in return. That and their pride in being Australian were the key factors in allowing the survivors to come through the 4 years' ordeal. To all who knew them in those days, they left behind a vivid memory. They were remembered not only for their soldiering, but also for their humour, their horseplay, and their vitality. Miles away in the Holy Land were the two Australian mounted divisions. Made up of natural horsemen from the country districts of Australia, they were the key instrument in the sweeping victories of Palestine and Syria. Sent overseas, 330,000. Killed, 60,000. Wounded and maimed, 166,000. 2 out of every 3 of the volunteers who went to the war were either killed or wounded. And hardly a home in the small nation was left untouched by the magnitude of the sacrifice. When the facts became known, every town and village in Australia built some form of memorial. Later in the 1920s, a feeling grew in Victoria that the size of the casualty list demanded something more. A group of returned men proposed that a larger memorial should be built to commemorate all Victorians killed in the Great War. In 1927, General Sir John Monash, after discussing the matter with a committee from Legacy, threw his weight behind the project, and a grand building was planned to be known as the Shrine of Remembrance. Building began on the King's Domain at the intersection of two of the most beautiful thoroughfares in Melbourne. It was opened in 1934 by the Duke of Gloucester before a crowd of no less than 300,000. From that day on, this remarkable memorial, in its classical Grecian style, became the focus of all commemoration in the state. And most of all, on that unique Australian day, Anzac Day.
Those of us who survived the war in 1918 knew that it was the worst thing that had ever happened. You couldn't talk about it to those who weren't there. They couldn't understand. So virtually, by mutual consent, we picked on April the 25th, Anzac Day, as a time to meet and remember.
There was nothing militaristic about it. Far from it. I'm sure the men were proud about the old units. They had every right to be. They'd made a name for Australia. But that wasn't all. We survivors knew we'd left our good mates behind. So despite the reunions, the bands and the jokes, we were there for one main thing, to remember the idea of mateship and self-sacrifice.
In the shrine grounds, there are two very special links with old Anzac. This tree was grown from seed sent home by one of the soldiers at Lone Pine, the site of one of the bitterest battles fought on the Gallipoli Peninsula, where in one day, Australians earned 7 Victoria Crosses. Beside it is a bronze sculpture. This little group, a man named Simpson helping a wounded man on his donkey, which he called Murphy, sums up better than 1,000 words what was at the heart of the Anzac legend. The shrine was barely 5 years old when the Second War burst upon the world in 1939. Once again, young Australians found it necessary to take up arms in defence of freedom, and this time for the very country itself. Many of them were the sons of 1914-18 fathers, and as well as serving in the army, they served in great numbers in the Air Force and on the seas.
We'll meet again. Don't know where, don't know when, but I know we'll meet again.
Between the years 1939 and 1945, there was hardly a continent on the globe which didn't see Australian servicemen from the skies of Europe to the jungles of the Pacific.
When the lights go on again, all over the world, and the boys are home again,
just you wait and see. There'll be love and laughter and peace ever after.
To commemorate those who lost their lives in the Second World War, an addition was made to the shrine in 1954. It took the form of a large forecourt at the northern approach. At one end of this, a plinth was built, topped by sculptured figures. They represent the men of the three services carrying the body of a fallen comrade. At the base of this was set the eternal flame. It was opened by Her Majesty the Queen.
To the glory of God, and in grateful memory of the men and women of this state who served in the Second World War, I dedicate this forecourt and set alight the flame in honor of all those who died for us. Let us ever be mindful that greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends.
Below the shrine, there is a crypt where the colors of the great Victorian battalions of the First War are laid up. In the center of this chamber is another post-war addition, the father and son statue, which is a unique reminder of the two generations of Victorians who fought in the two greatest wars the world has seen. Inside the shrine, the stepped dome leads the eye to a series of bas-reliefs, beautifully worked sandstone panels which depict the activities of the branches of the services in the Great War. The dome itself is supported by huge black marble columns. In this chamber is the very heart of the shrine, the Stone of Remembrance. Each year, at the exact time of the ending of the Great War in 1918, 11 a.m. on November the 11th, a beam of sunlight crosses the stone. Almost every day of the year sees one group or another paying a visit to the shrine, for every Victorian unit has its own day of remembrance. Among these are the young legatees, children of deceased servicemen, who once a year pay their respects at the shrine. Each tree around the shrine is its own special memorial to one of the old units. At this time, too, a bed of Flanders poppies comes into bloom. That the best parts of the Australian tradition, mateship and self-sacrifice, had to be confirmed in two world wars was a tragedy for our young nation. Nevertheless, the preservation of these great human qualities, even in the ordeal of war, is a thing well worth remembering. And that is what the shrine is about, sitting on its high hill in the domain. Its beauty is to be admired, as is the remembrance it stands for. Thank you.